You're gonna break into.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire. Across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous. My defense is impregnable. And I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live from the Billy C. Studio in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Caligero, and it's time for Talking Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening. Blah, 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 good evening. Hope you're doing all right.
Busy, busy, busy.
Show scheduled for today. You know, you know where that came from, right? That's like, it's this time of year, you know, when that comes from. From the Frosty the Snowman, right? Remember the Frosty the Snowman cartoon? You know, and the evil magician, you know, the guy that gave Frosty the hat, you know, he was the one that after Santa Claus, well, you know the story, right? And he goes running, you know, hops on one of those Norelco sleds, and he runs off. I'm busy, busy, busy. But anyway, busy show scheduled for today. But first, the show's being brought to you in part by Katz Nationwide Luxury Transportation Service. If you're looking for a limo in some place in the United States, even Canada, and you want a hot driver driving you around, you need my girl. That's right. But just remember, she's my girl, though. Okay? I know she's going to be tough to keep your hands off her, but remember, she's mine, mine, all mine. Katz Nationwide Luxury Transportation Service. Give her a call, 202-351-7496. That's 202-351-7496. Tell her Billy C sent you. But I'm telling you, remember, she's my girl. Katz Nationwide Luxury Transportation Service, 202-351-7496. Just call her. Say hi. Say Billy C says, hey, girl. Show's also being brought to you in part, man, that was corny. The show's also being brought to you in part by Campanaro and Tomkovich. If you're looking for a lawyer, use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That is Campanaro and Tomkovich, 845-221-4099. Hey, man, if you call him, make sure you tell him Billy C sent you, and make sure you tell him that I'm going to pick up the consultation fee. You know, somebody called from, like, they're located in New York, but somebody called from someplace out west, and And they have offices all over the country. But somebody called from out west and wanted them to represent them. And they said, Billy C said to Quality City, he's going to pick up the tab. He's going to pick up the tab. No. I said, I'm going to pick up the consultation fee if they charge you one. You know, Camping Air on Time, give them a call today, 845-221-4099. I'll pick up the consultation fee. But forget about the tab. You know what I mean? Forget about that. Come on, man. You're going to go commit a criminal act and then let me pay for it? No. I can't even pay attention. Anyway, the show's also being brought to you in part by my friends down at the Halftime Bar and Grill, Route 9, South Clinch Falls. Why do you want to go there? Well, if you like cool people, if you like drink specials all the time, if you like live entertainment on Friday and Saturday nights, and if you like fantastic food, that's why you go to the Halftime Bar and Grill, Route 9. South Glens Falls. Give them a call ahead, 518-792-4869. 518-792-4869. And the show's also being brought to you in part by ringside.com. That's right, man. For all of your boxing equipment needs, there's only one stop, and that is ringside.com. Call them today or email them today or visit the website today. Whatever, ringside.com. Just make sure you tell them Billy C sent you and demand the Billy C discount. And for all you people out there that buy boxing equipment in bulk, whether you own a gym, whether you're a trainer, maybe you just like to collect this stuff, I don't know. If you're going to buy something in bulk, make sure you email me and I'll hook you up even with a bigger and a better discount at ringside.com. So make sure you do that. Scheduled to join us a little bit later is Dax Khan. He's going to give us his weekly boxing roundup. We got some news. You know, I promised I was going to talk about you-know-who. But, you know, we have some relevant news about Floyd Mayweather Jr. He's talking about, you know, his next fights next week, next year. Well, we'll get to that news. He's claiming on being real busy next year. He's going to fight twice. But, you know, I don't believe it until I hear it. You know, I see that there's a contract signed and scheduled. You know, the thing is he has a tendency to come out with something every time Manny Pacquiao is in town. And by the way, forget about Manny Pacquiao and Floyd. It's not going to happen. It ain't going to happen. Floyd don't want to fight Manny Pacquiao. End of story. You know, Floyd's going to try to cherry pick another opponent or two and hang him up. But when you hear the discussion a little bit later, I think at least one of the two people that he's currently considering to fight is going to give him more than he thinks, more of a fight than he thinks. So we will talk about that a little bit later on the show. Also, don't forget about the shows we're doing this week. Special show Friday. That's right, this Friday, tomorrow, from between 6:30 and 7 p.m. Eastern Time. That's New York time, starting at 6:30 p.m. Make sure you tune in to Fight Now TV. It's also going to be on BillyCBoxing.com, so you can check out the feed there, too. We're going to be doing a post-weigh-in show. We got some people that are going to be ringside. My man Tony, or I should say scale side. My man Tony Treem is going to be out in Vegas, and he's going to be giving us a description of what went on at the weigh-in, how the guys looked and all that stuff. And then don't forget, immediately following the Manny Pacquiao Juan Manuel Marquez fight, the fourth one, immediately following that, make sure you tune in to BillyCBoxing.com and LDL. I mean, I'm sorry. And Fight Now. I know somebody's happy about that. And Fight Now TV for the post-fight show. And speaking of LDL TV, I'm sure we'll get them a copy of the screen, too. That's right. They'll be replaying it. So. But we want you to be awake, man. We want you to hang out. We want you to call in because we open up the phone lines and all that stuff. So two extra shows this week. One is the post-fight show immediately following Pacquiao-Marquez fight. And then, of course, tomorrow night we're going to do the weigh-in post-fight, post-weigh-in show. Man, I'm stumbling around. I feel like I had a couple of too many scotches. Anyway, also, cast your vote, man. You got one more day. Who's going to win the fight, Manny Pacquiao or Juan Manuel Marquez? We're at the Pacquiao is ahead. 66.7% of you think he's going to win, and 33.3% think that it's going to go the other way. So, you know, hey, cast your vote, man. You know, what are you waiting for? Cast your vote. You know, but Anyway, you know, yesterday I was talking about a heavyweight card. Now, don't get me wrong. I wasn't knocking the fighters on the card yesterday. The three heavyweights, making California boxing history, you know. And I was knocking the promoter because the promoter is thinks he's, you know, the best promoter in the world. As a matter of fact, he's the one, if I'm not mistaken, which I am, you know, frequently, he's the one that does the promoter's college or whatever. You know, talk about a guy with a big ego. And, you know, he's the promoter that thinks he's so famous that nobody's ever heard of him. Roy Engelbrecht is his name. And he was bragging about having the first fight card in the state of California that featured three heavyweights with 10 wins or more all on the same card. And you know, you read it and you're like, wow, that's good stuff. You know, and I was critical yesterday about the fighters and the opponents and everything else. I wasn't knocking the fighters. But check this out. Henry Haskett, very quickly, you know, our very own, I'm going to call him our very own, Henry Haskett, very quickly found a card in which there was more than three heavyweights on the card. He found one that had four heavyweights that all had 15 fights or more. With no losses, and one of them actually had, and then another one that had one loss. So you had four heavyweights with 15 more fights with no losses, and then another one with one loss, except it wasn't in the state of California. That was the thing. This one was in the state of New York. It was at Buffalo. As a matter of fact, I was ringside for that. And here's the thing. It was on HBO. We had Sam Peter. He was 15-0 at the time. And he knocked out Jason Farley in the second round. That was one. Juan Carlos Gomez was at the heavyweight division now. He was undefeated going into this fight, 36-0. Won a 10-round decision over Sinim Samuel Sam. That was a 10-round decision. So there's the second one. The third one was Dominic Gwynn, who had been undefeated at the time. He was 22-0. And he, too, won a 10-round decision over Duncan DeLowry in their fight. And the fourth one was Baby Joe Macy himself, man, was 26-0, knocked out Darrell Touch-A-Sleep Williamson in the first round on this card. It took place September 27th in 2003 in Buffalo, New York. And the bonus one was Sergey Lukajevich. He was 18-1. And he beat James Walton, knocked him out at 2 minutes and 7 seconds of the eighth round. So there you have it, a little tidbit. Roy Engelbrecht, maybe in California, but it sounds like a much better event took place in New York. You know, not New York City, but New York. I got to take a break. When I come back, I got some emails to read.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walk-in floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the ideal computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
Check out BillyCBoxing.com now, or feel the wrath of the mighty mustache.
Oh, that hurts. Why are you doing that to my face? I hate you. I hate you.
That's BillyCBoxing.com. Consider this your warning.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. Hey, you got some Christmas music. It's Christmas time. You're watching a replay on LDL TV. Glad you could join us. Check out the website, www.billycboxing.com, for all the latest news, interviews, stuff, poll questions, all that stuff. Check it out, man, because, you know, we've really made some leaps and bounds with the website over this past year. And one of the things that we like about it so much is that there's no pop-ups. You know, we get to the point. There's two sections for news. You can check out the right on the front page will be the biggest stuff that's going on, plus all of our own you know, writers and contributors and stuff. We get the front page, but then you have the latest boxing news, which is all the press releases that come out. Now, remember something: even if I don't like the news or the person or the fighter or whatever, it's up there because we're non-biased about the news. I have my opinions, but that doesn't mean I'm going to prevent you from getting them. So check it out, man. Make it your homepage: www.billycboxing.com. All right, we've got some emails. First and foremost, we got Daryl from Tampa. He says, I'm a long-time listener, but I'm a first-time emailer. Okay, well, that's cool. He says, you know, listening to the show and listening to Twisted Sister reminded me that I got to get that CD. Do you know where I can get it? I honestly don't know how I got it, but it's Twisted Sister's Christmas CD, I think, or whatever. Might have been in like a discount rack or something. I got in like July a couple of years ago. So he says, I love that stuff. He says, speaking of Christmas, Billy C, whatever happened to the Christmas carols, the Billy C Christmas carols? He says, you dissed us last year. Are you going to do a new one this year? Keep up the great work. Ciao, baby. Christmas, the Billy C Christmas carols. What Daryl's talking about is we did a... I got to explain this. What I used to do was... I used to send out what I called a Billy C. Christmas card. And basically it was our version of a popular Christmas thing. And I did it for the first couple of years. I did three of them, I think, three or four. And I didn't get a chance to do one last year. And this year, it's funny that he emails this to me because I was just thinking about this yesterday. When I was emailing some stuff to my man John. And I said, man, maybe I should do another one this year. I don't know if I'm going to have time, honestly. For all you new listeners and stuff, if you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll see if I could dig one up and play it in a little bit, all right? Now, I'm going to warn you. It's kind of embarrassing for me. So, I mean, you know, if you feel for me, take it as a grain of salt. You know, it's embarrassing for me. But we did it as a joke, okay? It's supposed to be funny. I sing in one, so, come on. All right, but they're Christmas. It's Christmas, and it's my versions of the Billy C versions of a couple of popular things. I'll see if I can find one at the next break, all right? And see if we can play one. I think there's three or four. So we're going to offer a Christmas CD. No. But Daryl from Tampa, long-time listener, first-time email. Come on, Daryl, we want you to email a little more. But anyway. My man Biggerback says, the reason for the fascination from the American to the heavyweights is there's a direct link from when Patterson won the vacant heavyweight title from Archie Moore to Lennox Lewis. The title of having a heavyweight championship fight is extremely sellable title more than a junior middleweight championship fight. Because of the history of that title, which made it such a prestigious name to have, and the fact that there's no confusion as who's the king. First it was Patterson, who then lost it to Liston, then to Ali, to Frazier, to Foreman, to Ali, to Holmes, to Spinks, to Tyson, to Holyfield, and finally to Lewis. I think it's more than that, Biggerback. I just think that the popular heavyweights, you're right about the lineage. I guess you're following the lineage here. I think the reason for the fascination from the American to the heavyweights, I think you hit it on the head at the end. I'm taking it, maybe I'm reading this wrong or it was printed for me wrong or whatever. It's like what I've said before, you know, when you were a kid, at least if you were a young boy, my age not that many people are still around that are my age, but on the playground, if you're in gym or playing at school or doing whatever, I don't know. Maybe kids today don't do it. They don't go to gym. They take gym with a Wii game or something. But it was always the thing. You know, when you won something, you know, you raise your hands and you're like, I'm the heavyweight champion of the world. You know, and King of the Hill or something, that was the title. You know, I mean, even today, I would think, I mean, you know, who says, I'm the World Series MVP of the world. You know, I'm the NFL Super Bowl champion, you know. Boxing has a lot of connections with many sports. I mean, I hear it, I'm a football fan. You guys know that. I hear it all the time, references to the sport of boxing, they'll say, an announcer will say something like, they're ready to this touchdown will be the knockout blow, to secure the game, or it looks like this team threw in the towel, it looks like an unintentional headbutt. No, I guess that, they don't use that, but, you're right about that, Biggerback. I mean, that's what it was, but, anyway, thanks for the email. Another email comes from Peter Henry. He says, you're completely wrong about the NFL thing and Europe. Europe and many other areas of the world have World Cup rugby. Unlike NFL, every player on a rugby squad is a potential boxer. And to prove the point, rugby has already produced world-class boxers. NFL has never produced a world-class boxer. Never produced a boxer that was world-class. The World Cup rugby squad of New Zealand currently has an up-and-coming undefeated heavyweight in Sonny Bill Williams. He'll fight anybody in the NFL and knock him out. Anthony Mundine did it. All right, so what Peter Henry's referring to, as I said yesterday, maybe because we have more heavyweights in England, because they don't have the opportunities that they have in the United States. And I use the NFL as an example. You know, a guy that might be a potential animal in the sport of boxing might choose to go with, football or NFL football or even basketball or baseball here in the States. I did not mean to offend anyone with Europe you know, saying that their sports weren't, you know, as good. Number one, rugby is a tough sport. I mean, I enjoy watching it, you know, and those guys are beasts. There's no question about it. And, of course, so is soccer and all the other sports. I wasn't saying I didn't mean it like that. However, you know, if you want to call me completely wrong, okay. But, you know, I'd be interested to see the numbers. I know the NFL is a pretty big and successful organization that, you know, houses a couple of thousand elite athletes. The best athletes in the world are on NFL football teams. And I'm not talking about the superstars you hear. You know, even a guy sitting a bench, even a guy holding a clipboard is a super elite athlete just to make it to the NFL. So I don't know about that. And the other thing I find humorous is you refer to Sonny Bill Williams. I'm going to give you the lowdown on him in a minute after the break here. But Sonny Bill Williams, please. And to make a statement, Peter, I mean, I'm glad you're listening to the show, and I really appreciate you taking the time to email us. But are you for real? You're saying that every single player that plays rugby in England or Europe, I should say, is a potential superstar boxer? I mean, you say every player on a rugby squad is a potential boxer. Come on, man. Come on. I think you're exaggerating a little bit. Hold that thought. Great email, great topic. We'll be back in two.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Broadcasting in all corners of the globe, on the web and radio.
He would scoff at a stretch of that man, I would think.
You're listening to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. From upstate New York in the good old U.S. of A.
Boxing is here to stay because we are here to stay.
The best 2 hours of boxing talk on the airwaves.
Hey, fight fans, check out KOFantasyBoxing.com. KO Fantasy Boxing is boxing's only trademarked fantasy game. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. And tell them Billy C sent ya.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C, the only radio host man enough to take a punch from Mike Tyson.
Wait a minute, man. Hold on there, Jeremy, man. I need you to take this one, all right?
Wait, what? No way. I can't do this.
Need I remind you I'm Billy C, damn it? Now put on that mustache and get in there.
Hey, look at me. I'm Billy C. Crap.
The undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
And we're back. You are listening to the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C show. Yeah, you got a little Christmas tunes going on. I want to welcome the Fight Now audience just joining us, like they do every day from Monday through Friday from 6 to 7:30 a.m. Eastern Time. And if you don't have the Fight Now channel on your sports channel lineup, now's a good time to get it. Because the big fight this weekend, Manny Pacquiao against Juan Manuel Marquez, number four is going to feature, we're going to feature on Fight Now, over 20 hours of extended coverage, which actually began yesterday. It's going to follow up today. We are doing a special post-weigh-in show tomorrow, so tune in right here on Fight Now TV at 6:30 p.m. tomorrow night, Friday night, and catch us live. We got some people ring that are going to be weight scale side. We're calling it scale side, and give us the rundown on what took place at the weigh-in. And then don't forget the post-fight right after the Manuel Marquez, Juan Manuel Marquez and Manny Pacquiao show fight is over, Manny Pacquiao show. The Manny Pacquiao Marquez fight, when it's over, tune in right here on Fight Now. We got the post fight show. We got some guests coming. I got some reporters that are going to be ringside. We're going to open up the phone lines. All that happy stuff going on right here on Fight Now TV. So all the information about Fight Now, you can find it on their website, www.fightnow.com. One thing I'm definitely going to find is a spell checker for my man Dax. He's a Batman riddler all the time. You know, he's constantly emailing stuff. He's in the chat room right now, and you know, I got to look at what he writes and try and decipher what he's saying, because you know, he's talking about his kids. You know, and look at him. He's got my kids Gad knee watching too much Wii last night. Come on, Dax. Look before you hit enter, man. Anyway, speaking of Dax, we're going to have Dax joining us at the next break. That's right, 6:30 he'll be here, so make sure you stick around for that. Peter Henry says, I'm totally wrong about the NFL in Europe. Says rugby, as a matter of fact. He says, unlike the NFL, every player on a rugby squad is a potential boxer. And to prove the point, rugby has already produced world-class boxers. Who? Name one. Hey, Peter Henry, send me a rugby player that's a world-class boxer. A world-class boxer. Don't be sending me some European ranked fighter. So I want a world-class name. He throws in Sonny Boy Williams. Now, Sonny Boy Williams, I followed this story. So Peter actually has caught something with something that I actually followed. Now, Sonny Bill Williams is a rugby player now. He's a young kid. He's 27 years old out of Australia, well, out of New Zealand. And he's undefeated right now. He has been campaigning as a heavyweight. He hasn't fought too often. His first fight was in 2009, and his last fight was in February of this past year. He was supposed to fight again, from what I understand, but injured himself. I believe the Clarence Tillman fight, which was his last fight in February, was actually, people were complaining that it was stopped prematurely. Listen, man, this guy is 5-0 with three knockouts. He's only got 16 rounds under his belt, and he's 6'3". Now, the statement that Peter Henry said he could knock out any NFLer, okay, that, you know, may or may not be true. But he's certainly not a world-class fighter, and he's certainly never going to be a world-class fighter. I'll tell you that right now. I'll make that statement right now, that Sonny Bill Williams will never become a world-rated fighter. At 5-0, with five fights for the last 3 years, and at 6'3". Now, 6'3" is a monster compared to me, all right? At 6'3", that's a monster for me. Kevin the Fraud Johnson, the biggest fraud in boxing, he's 6'3", and go look at how small he looked against the heavyweights of today, like a Tyson Fury. You know, Sonny Bill Williams, right now, to give you an idea, you know, Peter Henry says he's you know, could be a world-class fighter. 18 wins, his combined opponents' records are 18 wins, 19 losses, and 2 draws. I will say this. From an experience point of view, that's not bad for a guy with five fights under his belt. So I don't know, man. Peter, you got to give me more. You got to give me more if you're trying to back up your case that all rugby players are potential boxers and all rugby players will beat up on NFL guys. Listen, one thing we've talked about, Marty Mulcahy, who joins us on Fridays, you know, he's made this statement many times. You know, it's boxing. The reason why other sports athletes that try to make the transition from their sport to boxing, the reason why it's so difficult is because it's like your muscle tone gets trained when you're boxing. In other words, if you start off boxing at a young age and you know, continue to get better and work on the exercises and the muscle that you work on as a boxer, it's different muscle tone. The muscle remembers those moves or whatever versus what you're doing in football and rugby. You know, rugby isn't a burst sport like football. So a lot of the NFL players are training in bursts, you know, speed bursts. They run a lot of sprints and they're good for that kind of stuff. I like rugby, but to make a statement like all rugby players are potential potential football boxers is kind of crazy. But I'm just curious to know. I want to hear any former rugby player that was a world class boxer. I will tell you this, Pete. As far as rugby, they make some pretty damn good football players, and I'm talking about NFL football. We got several rugby players in the NFL right now that are all doing very well. So. Give me more info, Pete. I'm interested. Manophonics says, on Manny versus Marquez, if Marquez wins, will there be a fifth fight? If Marquez gets robbed, again, will there be a fifth fight? If it's a draw, will there be a fifth fight? The point being, this matchup is played out. Only a Manny win by knockout, and he says, which I don't see him outboxing Marquez, will put an end to this. Watch. I'm sorry. We'll put an end to this, which is what I'm hoping for, honestly. So there's only one more obstacle before we get the fight we want. Mano, I agree with you. I thought that this fight would have been great as a dual farewell. I think it would have sold. I think both fighters would have said see you later to the sport of boxing and walked away with a big payday. I do think that this fourth fight is a little drawn out here a little bit. But I don't think we're going to see that fight that you're referring to. And we're going to be giving you some Floyd Mayweather news in a few minutes here. But I don't think you're going to see that fight. So, I think what we're going to see from Manny, should he beat Juan Manuel Marquez again Saturday night, I think we're going to see Manny fight Timothy Bradley. And maybe that's it. Maybe another Cotto fight. I don't know. But don't count on Manny and you-know-who. You-know-who wants no part of Manny Pacquiao. He's rather going to go fight a guy like Guerrero or Saul Canelo Alvarez and risk losing to... Canelo's not going to beat him, but Robert Agosto might. Only because Floyd's not going to break him down, mentally, physically, nothing. So we'll have to wait and see. EQX says, everyone's talking about a potential fight between Broner and Gamboa. I think that sounds exciting, and it's a long way off. I would have to go with Gamboa if it ever does happen. Who's talking about a Broner and Gamboa fight? I think technically it sounds good, but Gamboa's way smaller than Broner. You know, Gamboa is just moving up out of the featherweight division right now. Maybe not. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, they could be a potential matchup. But I think that Adrian Broner is actually going to be comfortable at junior welter or even welter over the next couple of years. Remember, he's only 23. He's only 23 years old. Who knows? And I got news for you. I love Gamboa, but I don't know if Gamboa could handle the power of Broner. Broner has power. He does. You know, that's what makes him more exciting than you-know-who, in my opinion. Like my man Given Quality says, let's not rush him. Let's let him fight the fight in lightweight and then see what happens. You know, I don't want him to linger around at lightweight, but you never know. Let's see. Vinny King says, what do you think about Mike Molo, who's recently had bouts with Franklin Yaya Lawrence and Chris Areola and Seth Mitchell all fall out? All of those fighters backed out of the fight. Mike only lost three fights by decision. He's got 20 wins. He's been out of the ring for 2 years, and he's ready to get back in the ring. What do you think of him? Vinny, I don't know what to tell you about Mike Molo. I have seen him ringside a couple of times, and the last time I saw him was actually in New York at Madison Square Garden back in 2008. Andrew Golota. I saw him fight, And he looked very good. As a matter of fact, it was a pretty close fight. How do I think he would fare? Well, you know, his last two fights, he fought in 2010. He fought some journeyman fighters in Billy Zumbrum and Gary Gomez. He struggled with Gomez. He didn't even get a win out of that one. He got a majority draw. You know, the most he's ever weighed was 228 pounds. He's only 6'1". You know, I think that he's a good journeyman or gatekeeper kind of a guy as far as making a run for a world title or something like that. I don't see it. I don't see it. Although, you know, if a guy like Mike Molo, if he had a couple of fights under his belt, and then, you know, maybe he gets a match with a guy like Povetkin, he's got a chance. The problem with Mike Molo is he made a big mistake and signed with a promoter that doesn't know a thing about boxing. You know, I'm not going to mention the promoter, but if you know who his promoter is, the guy has taken every fighter he signed, and they all lose. You know, he's like one of these promoters that's just excited to get a fight scheduled and then doesn't even think about, you know, what's going on. So anyway, the news I was talking about was Floyd Mayweather. It was announced yesterday that according to one of his advisors, Leonard Ellerbe, says that Mayweather will be fighting two times in 2013. I know we've heard that many times before, but he wants to fight on Cinco de Mayo, which has been his MO lately, and also on September 14th. He calls it, Floyd Mayweather wants to rename Cinco de Mayo to be called Cinco de Mayweather, which I think is a joke. He says, and you know, go back and listen to my shows about Floyd Mayweather, and I had asked a question once that, you know, I got mixed results from, mixed feelings from people about, you know, I said, do you think that, you know, because fighters are in like a lottery, you know, are they in awe of Floyd? You know, when they fight Floyd, are they already, you know, too respectful, too over-respectful? They're not like going in there to rough him up, give him a heart. It's almost like, you know, there's rules you got to follow. Like you can't go in there and, you know, have a rough and tumble fight, not with Floyd, because that's not part of the deal, you know. And, you know, I said sometimes fighters, in my opinion, it's like I feel fighters already felt like they had a victory because they won the big payday, so to speak. They hit the lottery. Well, it's funny because Ellerbe almost says the same thing. He says Floyd Mayweather has a plethora of options. Who doesn't want to fight Floyd Money Mayweather and make the most money they ever made in their career? You hit the lottery once you've become a Floyd Mayweather opponent. Yeah, you know, so let's make sure we remember that when we start talking about the history down the road 20 years from now. All you young boxing fans that become the historians long after I'm looking at the grass from the opposite side, just remember that Floyd Mayweather's main goal was to find guys that he could beat, opponents he could beat, and give them a payday, and, you know, didn't go out and seek the best. And, you know, his main goal is the money, which is fine. That's fine for his bank account. But we'll see. Who's top in the list, the short list? Well, Manny Pacquiao's not on that list. I don't think, you know, they're talking about him fighting Robert Agos Guerrero and then Saul Alvarez for the two fights. As a matter of fact, Saul Alvarez, it looks like he's going to be on the same card. It looks like Floyd Mayweather most likely will fight Robert Agos Guerrero on Cinco de Mayo, May 5th, and then come back in September and fight Saul Alvarez should he win. Whoever he's going to fight, which looks like it's going to be Miguel Cotto. That fight's already, regardless of the fact that Cotto, you know, lost. And that is indicative of the way the blueprint goes. You know, fighters look for the easiest way out, the least amount of risk for the most amount of reward. Look at Miguel Cotto. Despite losing to Austin Trout, and we know, we're boxing fans, we know that he lost to Austin Trout because, why? Because Austin Trout's better, right? But the public, the Joe Q public who's not a diehard boxing fan, they've heard of Miguel Cotto. They have not heard of Austin Trout. So Miguel Cotto still has his value. So Saul Alvarez, a win over Miguel Cotto was a name. even though a win over Austin Trout would unify titles and you know, be more of a significant win from the boxing purist point of view, you're going to see them pick the least troublesome fighter, and that is Miguel Cotto. Miguel Cotto is not the same fighter anymore. Dax and I were talking about this the other day. Miguel Cotto's turned into a brawler. He doesn't do anything. He's not the same fighter as he was as a junior welterweight. You know, I mean, he's a name. He sells, and that's it. Canelo Alvarez is following the same path. This is a kid that, in my opinion, is technically sound. He does do things by the book, which I like. But who's he fought? You know, given quality, said, you know, what guy is he fought? And he's right. Who's he fought? He's fought nobody. This is a joke. This is a guy that is a public guy. People like him, you know, and he sells tickets. And even Dax was saying in New York, people were cheering for him. They love him. Everybody loves him. You know, so why should he fight? You know, why should he fight anybody? Why should he really, you know, he's an entertainer is what he is. People want to see him in the ring. They want to see him win. They want him to wave when he's in the audience. And I think the majority of the people don't care if he fights anyone good or not. So they're going to oblige, and they're going to give him the weaker opponents, just like Floyd. Floyd doesn't want to fight anybody tough. You know, I got news for you. If he fights Robert Ghost Guerrero, he may see some chinks in Guerrero's armor, and you know, maybe everybody jumped the gun a little bit with Robert Ghost Guerrero and his destruction over Andre Berto and everything else. But I will say this about Robert Ghost Guerrero: he's not going to get he's not going to fall into the BS. Floyd's not going to beat him mentally, and Floyd's not going to break him down physically. I don't think Floyd can hurt Robert Ghost Guerrero. Now, Floyd's got the speed, and he could counterpunch Robert Ghost Guerrero, and he could be, incorporate his shoulder roll defense and be safe. But here's the difference. This is the part where I believe that Robert Ghost Guerrero is a dangerous opponent for Floyd Mayweather. The reason is because Robert Ghost Guerrero will take those two or three or four or even six shots to get in close, and those six shots are not going to hurt Robert Ghost Guerrero. Listen, if Andre Berto landed two and three uppercuts flush on the chin button and, you know, didn't phase the Ghost, I'm telling you right now, I don't care how fast Floyd is, the little girly man doesn't have the power to knock out the Ghost. So the Ghost is going to come in. He's going to take those shots, and when he gets Floyd against the corner, against a corner post or against the ropes or something like that, I would think that he's going to work the body like he did with Andre Berto, and that is going to drop the hands a little bit of Floyd, and you're going to see Floyd break down. Listen, I'm going to give Floyd all the credit in the world for fighting Robert Ghost Guerrero, because let's face it, and Floyd should know this, unless his ego is starting to cloud his judgment, because up until this point, he's really been successful at you know, finding a fighter's weakness and exploiting it during the fight. You know, yeah, I'm sure Robert Ghost has weaknesses that Floyd thinks he's going to exploit, but I think Robert Ghost Guerrero is a much tougher hombre than Floyd is going to expect, and he may not even get out of that fight to fight Saul Alvarez. So, you know, what's an alternative? You know, unfortunately for Floyd, if he wants to continue his career, which he really doesn't have to, if he wants to continue his career, there are a couple of guys in the upper echelon of the fighters today, and no, they're not rugby players, but, you know, in the upper echelon of the fighters that he could face. You know, and the names that we're talking about, you know, the Saul Alvarez, I don't think Floyd has a problem with him. You know, he just he's not experienced enough. I could see Floyd knocking out Saul Alvarez, to be honest with you. I could see Alvarez getting knocked out by Austin Trout. You know, I think when Saul Alvarez loses, it's going to be by knockout. He does something really stupid. He locks his legs when he stands there and unleashes his arsenal. His knees are like locked in place. They're not flexible, it seems. And Floyd will destroy him. That, you know how styles make fights? Everybody's all psyched on Canelo. Well, I got news for you. His style is exactly what Floyd loves. Floyd would love to get in the ring with Saul Alvarez. So don't think that he's avoiding Saul Alvarez because he's afraid of him. You know, he's trying to build it up a little more. He wants Saul Alvarez to maybe get a little better. I don't know. But when you look at Robert De Gos Guerrero, that's a dangerous opponent for Floyd. Who else is left? You know, when you take Robert De Gos Guerrero out of the mix, you take Saul Alvarez out of the mix, who's left? Does anybody want to see him fight Cotto? You know, again, does anybody want to see him fight Juan Manuel Marquez? Everybody wants to see him fight Manny Pacquiao, but that fight's not going to happen. It's not. It's just not going to happen. You know, I hate to say it, but it's just not. And it's a shame. And speaking of Canelo, according to Team Canelo and Team Cotto, they're negotiating a fight right now. That fight is nowhere near off the table, you know, because of the interest. You know, people still want to see it. They, you know, so you know, crazy stuff. Crazy stuff, that's for sure. But anyway, you know, we'll have to wait and see what happens there. But we had the Manny Pacquiao and Juan Manuel Marquez final press conference yesterday. And a couple of quotes that were pretty publicized were, you know, Manny Pacquiao says he needs, referring to Juan Manuel Marquez, he needs to prove something, and I'm ready for that. I'm hoping for a good fight with more action, and so people enjoy it. I'll leave no doubt in the mind of the fans. He has to. You know, really, the guy has to. You know, so we'll have to wait and see if it actually comes up. You know, so anyway, also Juan Manuel Marquez says this will be another war because I know Manny and Manny knows me. I've prepared myself very hard and I know it's going to be a war. That doesn't sound like a guy that's confident that he's going to win. I would have liked to have heard Juan Manuel Marquez come back and say something like, you know, I really want this time it's going to be different. I'm going to win. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Whatever. You know, all of that stuff. You know, it's going to be a war. Well, we know it's going to be a war. We know it's going to be a war. You know, that we already know. You know, so I don't know. I was expecting something a little different from him, at least, you know, for the PR. Nacho Bernstein, he says that these are the best 2-pound-for-pound fighters in the world. They're facing each other. You're going to see a great fight, just like the other three. Freddie Roach says, I love this rivalry. Winning the fourth fight will be the icing on the cake. It's not just so much winning the fourth fight. I think Manny has to win decisively, and decisively means by knockout. All right, listen, I promised you guys that I would embarrass myself a little bit. I found the very first one we did, and it happens to be my favorite one. And it was done in 2008, so it's been a few years. Like I said, I didn't do one last year. I did one in 2008. I did one in 2009. I did one in 2010. But I didn't do one last year. Maybe we'll do one this year. I don't know, man. It was funny at the time. I'm going to play it for you right now. This is my version. This is the Billy C version of one of my favorite Christmas poems, okay? This is me doing it. I did it in 2008. I sent it to everybody. And enjoy this. I think you're going to like it. And when we come back, we'll have Dax Khan on. So this was my Christmas card to all the boxing people in 2008. I hope you like it.
There it was, the night before Christmas, and all true to house. Not a creature was stirring, not even a friggin' mouse. The boxing gloves were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that that fat guy in a red suit would soon be there. All tree kids, Sonny, Mike, and Rocky, were all snug in their beds with visions of Sugar Ray Robinson dancing in their heads. With the old lady dressed in, actually, I forget what she had on, but I was in these feety pajamas and a cool-looking cap, and we both got under the covers for, you know, a little nap. When all of a sudden there was this friggin' noise. It sounded like Ernie Shavers pounding a heavy bag. The walls, they started creaking and cracking and created such a clatter that I jumped out of the sack to see what was the matter. I tripped over a dumbbell and on the way down got tangled up in a jump rope. I was up at the count of three, then stumbled over to the window in kind of a flash. I had to move all the hand wraps out of the way and finally was able to throw open the sash. All I wanted to do was see what the hell was going on out there. The moon on the breast of the new fallen snow gave the luster of midday to the outdoor boxing ring and all the other objects below, when what to my wondering reattached retina eye should appear but this big red sled and eight of them reindeers. There was this little old driver. He looked just like Angelo Dundee. He was so lively and quick that I knew in a 10-second warning signal that it must be that fat guy named Saint Nick. Those deers, they were coming in like punches in bunches, but all seemed tame when the fat guy whistled and shouted and he called them by name. Now Johnson, now Burns, now Hitman Hearns, and Sammy Angott. On Ambers, on Liston, on Langford and Jersey Joe Walcott. To the top of the porch, to the top of the wall. Now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As the will-o'-wisp danced, and he seemed to fly, and how the greatest himself rose to heights as high as the sky. Up to the housetop, the whole team flew with that big old sled full of boxing stuff and toys and that fat guy in a red suit, too. Then I hear this thud on my roof, and it sounded like a crashing and banging of each one of those deer's hooves. I gotta be honest, as I was turning around, I thought to myself, I hope they don't all take a crap up there. And then down the chimney comes this fat guy in a bound. He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot. And his clothes, they were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys and all kinds of boxing stuff he had flung on his back. And he looked like a peddler just opening his sack. His eyes, how they twinkled. His dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses. His nose was red as a friggin' cherry. I was thinking he had a few too many scotches, to be honest with you. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and he had a long beard that was as white as the snow. The stump of a stogie he held tight in his teeth, and by the smell of the smoke I could tell he was hanging out with Cheech. He had a tough-looking face and a big but solid-looking belly. But when he saw the top 10 heavyweights of 2008, he laughed and it shook like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump. Okay, he was a fat bastard, but a right jolly old elf, and I had to laugh because in him I saw myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head gave me the feeling I had nothing to dread, so I put down my gun. He didn't say a word and went straight to his work, stacking up presents and filling up the gloves, and then he turned with a jerk. He put his finger on the side of his nose. He gave me a quick nod, and up the chimney he rose. He sprang to the sled, and to his team he gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim as he flew out of sight, "Billy C. says Merry Christmas to all, and have fun at the fights."
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. now has official merchandise available on TalkinBoxing.com. T-shirts, sweatshirts, hoodies and mugs, and yes, even undergarments. Talkin' Boxing apparel is the perfect gift for the boxing fan in your life. Log on to www.talkinboxing.com. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And place your order today.
Join us here for 2 hours as Billy and the gang do what they do best.
Every time I start talking about boxing, a white man got to pull Rocky Marciano's ass. Rocky Marciano was good, but compared to Joe Louis, Rocky Marciano ain't.
It's Joe Louis's ass.
Joe Louis was 75 years old when he fought.
Huh? What?
We're supposed to be talking boxing.
It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
As Billy C. sits here in the multi-million dollar Talking Boxing Studios, sipping a fine wine before you're even out of bed, you should be thinking, damn, I wish I had a mustache like his. It's the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. show. He's Billy C., and you're not. Sucks to be you.
Now let's dig into our archives and hear a rare interview when Billy C. first became the champion of boxing talk radio. Hello, Billy C. As the new champ, can we ask you a few questions?
Why, certainly.
Okay, your fans would like to know how you and your corner have successfully walloped the competition.
We're not ordinary people. We're morons.
Anything else?
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Did your success finally come when you made the show 5 days a week for 2 hours? What do you think?
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Now, please tell the listeners what you've learned from making it this far.
Fight me! If at first you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed.
Great words of wisdom, Billy C. Keep up the great work as the undisputed People's Champion with your show, Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Any last words to anyone who's listening?
This is your fault, you bonehead!
I'll have a blue Christmas without you. I'll be so blue just thinking about you.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Box with Billy C. Show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. And don't forget, call your local television provider, whether it's satellite dish or cable, and tell them you want Fight Now right now. It's a great time to do it, man. Got a busy, busy week scheduled leading up to the big fight. Juan Manuel Marquez against Manny Pacquiao for the fourth time. And you can check it out, some of the preliminary bouts and some added stuff post and pre and even during the big fight, only on Fight Now TV. So check it out. Check out the website, www.fightnow.com, for all the information. Yeah, I told you guys that I was going to embarrass myself a little bit with that Twas the Night, the Billy C version of Twas the Night Before Christmas. There are a couple of other ones that are even more embarrassing. One I even sing, which is pretty bad. And I know this guy's going to crack up when he hears it. But joining us right now is my man Dax Khan. What's up, brother?
What's up? The ratings booster from Down by Brewster, baby.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we had to do something with after that, after I played that. But hey, real quick, what's your thoughts on the Austin Trout Miguel Cotto fight? You were there ringside. You and I talked about the card and the shot. You shocked me when you told me that it was half full. Give me a lowdown on you know, the atmosphere first, and then the fight itself. And are you surprised that Canelo Alvarez is still seeking Miguel Cotto, even though he lost?
Canelo Alvarez was standing, well, not standing, but he was sitting ringside, and when he was sitting there, he was seething. He wanted both those guys, you know. I think at one point in time, somebody said he actually leaned over, and he had said something in Spanish about, like, easy paydays.
For both fights? I don't know. I don't know if Austin Trout would be an easy payday for Saul Alvarez. I just don't think he's there yet. I think he's got a lot of potential and stuff, but this whole road to a this whole road of a champion today, you know, where you get a young kid, you feed him cupcakes, you buy him a belt, basically, like they did with Canelo, and then he learns on the job as a champion. I can't stand it, man. I like the old days when they fought their way up through the contenders, you know, the first 10, the rank 10, and all the way up to number one, and then fought for a title. I think they're better fighters when they do it that way.
Well, that's what happens nowadays when world championships can be gotten inside any fortune crane game at a local diner.
Exactly.
Because that's how many of them there are.
True.
But I agree with you 100%. Yeah, you know, it was always, you know, that's how we got all these expressions. That's how all these things came up. That's how it came up, you know, prospect. And that's how you came up, contender. That's how, you know, why we developed our rating systems. And, you know, and that's why we had the word challenger to challenge for a world title. But, you know, just nowadays, if whoever's going to sell the tickets, that's why, you know, I was kidding around in the chat room about, you know, the ratings booster from Down by Brewster said last night, thanks a lot for correcting my typing on there, but last night talking about I'm watching too much wrestling with the kids, you know, everything's a tagline, and if you can sell tickets, they're going to put a title belt around your waist one way or another. It doesn't matter how good you are. I always refer to the biggest fraud that I've always thought in boxing. Somebody mentioned that. Matter of fact, J-Man mentioned it in the chat room a couple weeks ago. Thomas Damgaard from over in Denmark, he was like 36-0 when he had fought Arturo Gatti went over and walked over him. But you know what? He had a title, and he was the man because he had that title belt around his waist. Titles don't make the fighter. The fighter makes the titles. Unfortunately, it's too commercialized now, like Christmas.
And not only that, but when you feed that BS with the network, the television network executives looking for titles to put on their you know their television channels and stuff like that, you're actually promoting and letting those BS titles survive longer. You know, it's like a bloodline. You know, they all complain. You know, it cracks me up. The promoters all complain about the belts too, but they're the ones that are basically feeding these sanctioning bodies.
Absolutely. You know, the more that, you know, we started getting excited because TV was, you know, regular TV or such as, you know, the CSNBC network, the NBC Sports network, is bringing back, you know, big time fights back, you know, trying to make like the old days when fights were on CBS or ABC. But meanwhile, every fight that they have on there as a main event, they're trying to make for a title fight. Have you noticed, or is it just me, the plethora and return of state titles? You know, the New York state title, the Florida state title, anything just to have that word title inside there, because if they think if there's the word title in it, it's going to sell and that's all you need. It doesn't matter what the record of the fighters are.
Exactly. And here's the other part. What they're actually trying to target is they're trying to target that casual fan. The fan that normally doesn't follow boxing and maybe a live boxing event comes to their, you know, local civic center or whatever in their town, and they see on an ad, if the promoter actually puts an ad out or anything, you know, that it's a title fight, and they, you know, they're thinking, oh, maybe I'll go then, you know, and it's terrible because we, the boxing public, the true boxing fans, they know who's who. They know whether you care about a title. I mean, I could care less about titles, you know. I mean, our rankings indicate that, you know. But anyway, hey, listen, run through your rundown now because, I mean, I got 15 fights on the challenge alone. It's a busy weekend. Why don't we get that out of the way, and then we'll talk about some of the big fights this weekend.
All right. You know, but, yeah, as you were saying the other day when you mentioned a belated happy birthday to Devon, or as we call him down by me, Devin, which was very nice of you, by the way, you said that same exact thing. It's all about what looks like on paper and how it looks down on that piece of paper. It doesn't matter if you fought 40 cab drivers. As long as you're 40, you know that's going to sell. This week, though, starting tonight at the Mirage Hotel and Casino, Las Vegas, Nevada, lightweight Raymond Beltran defends his NABF lightweight title against Ji-Hoon Kim. Super bantamweight Jesse Magliano and Jonathan Aureliano will go at it for the vacant WBO NABO youth super bantamweight title. That's the top ranked card to be aired on ESPN2. And our own Shelly Williams is going to be in attendance Friday, December 7th. Route 66 Casino in Albuquerque, New Mexico, light welterweight Holly Holm defends her IBA female light welterweight title while trying to claim the vacant WBF female light welterweight title when she takes on the hard-hitting Diana Prazak. Prazak was trained for this bout by the all-time, in my opinion, pound-for-pound best female fighter to date, Lucia Riker. It's interesting to see how that one plays out. On the undercard, two potential opponents for the winner of that, light welterweight Victoria Cisneros and Mary McGee are going to go at it. At the Texas Fish Casino in Las Vegas, USA Azteca will air the second of three top-ranked events this week when welterweight Jesse Vargas faces Vito Gasparian as co-attraction unbeaten heavyweight Andy Ruiz Jr. faces Elijah McCall. George Foreman's son actually fights tonight in Mexico. It would be a nice contest of future potential contenders should the winner of those bouts face each other. As we're always sitting and talking every week, hoping that the heavyweight division's getting better. And, you know, little by little, we're starting to see situations like that when, you know, a lot of potential fights for excitement in the future are coming around to help build up that division again. And Herring, Denmark on Saturday on United Kingdom Sky TV and Hungary Digisport, Polestat Extra, and SPAG promoted card. In the main event, Brian McGee and Mikel Kessler are going to battle for the WBA World Super Middleweight title. Kingston, Jamaica, that's a location we barely or rarely ever, as a matter of fact, I don't remember ever mentioning that in one of my roundups, is going to broadcast on Peru ATV television. A vacant WBA World Featherweight title seeks an owner when in the main event, featherweight Nicholas Waters brings his 21-0 record and journey to seek that belt and bring it home when he faces the brother of Bradis Prescott, DeLewis Prescott, In the co-feature super bantamweight, Elise Sanchez defends her interim WBA female superweight bantamweight title against Maria Ella Villanuevos. Tina Malaparina defends her WBA super featherweight title against Stacey Riel. In the United Kingdom, Hennessy Sports has a show to be aired on Walt TV and UK Channel 5 as super middleweight James DeGale meets former world title challenger Florencia Zuniga for the vacant WBC super middleweight title. On the undercard, a plethora of unbeaten prospects are also scheduled to fight, including 12-0 super bantamweight Tim Galahad, and Chris Eubanks Jr., who just fought last week, is on that card as well. You talk about somebody who's keeping a busy pace. I think this is his ninth fight in 2012. And United Kingdom Sky TV is also going to have another card thrown by Eddie Hearn of Matchroom Boxing when middleweight Darren Barker faces Kerry Hope to fill the vacant IBF Intercontinental middleweight title. Light middleweight Aaron Oaching takes on Max Maxwell and defenses for his BBBFC English light middleweight title as a co-feature. In Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, main event broadcast on the NBC Sports Network that we were talking about before. In the feature bout, heavyweight Brian Bye Bye Jennings defends his USBA heavyweight title against Bowie Tapua. And the co-feature super featherweight Jerry Belamontes looks to remain undefeated against Eric Hunter. And the big one this weekend at the MGM Grand Garden Arena in Las Vegas, where they play host to an HBO pay-per-view event, Manny Pacquiao and Juan Manuel Marquez meet for a fourth time. As if that's even really necessary, I'm not even sure what, you know, the idea that's going on. I just find that fight totally preposterous. Uriokas Gamboa is going to face Michael Frinas and seek out, the winner's going to become the interim WBA World Super Featherweight Champion. Lightweight Miguel Vasquez defends his IBF lightweight title against unblemished Mercedo Gesta. And featherweight Javier Fortuna battles the kid who lives right down the street from me, the Irish transplant, Patrick Hyland, for the interim WBA World Featherweight title. And featherweight Dodie Boy Penelosa Jr., who's 9-0 with all 9 wins coming by way of knockout, is going to be on that card as well to add some excitement just in case the headliners cannot. That card is in conjunction with Top Rank, Xanifer Promotions, Curtis Jackson's SMS Promotions, and Marquez Boxing. You know, it seems like everybody has their promotion company, doesn't it? And now we're talking about world titles. I must have mentioned 30 different belts inside of 15 cards.
It's a shame. I really.
Was there any fight on there that wasn't a title fight?
No, and that's the way it is, man. I mean, there's more fighters, I believe, with belts than there are without belts. But it's crazy. You know, to comment on what you said, I like the fact that the former fighters are entering into the promotional ranks. I think it's good. I just wish that they would, you know, take that deep plunge and try and be a main player rather than a, you know, just a promoter that feeds the big guys, you know?
You know, being a former fighter, you know, I'm up against the wall on that one, you know. Being the former fighters having a promotion company, in one way I'm saying to myself, you know, this is great because they understand, you know, how to make sure that a fighter keeps their percentage. They know what was taken from them, how things weren't done fairly to them, you know, exactly how they could have ended up with more money in the future. They realize, you know, exactly what fights hurt them, you know, that were being pushed overs and, you know, how that hurt them later on in their career. But then again, on the other side, the word promoter just slaps me around upside the head like a pimp and his prostitute who didn't pay the $20 after she got out of the backseat of a Cadillac in the Bronx, because you know what? Once you become a promoter, you become greedy, and you know something? That just bothers me altogether. There's a promotion company I'm not going to mention the name of, but you know something? When that promotion company came out, everybody was excited, and later on, you know something? They just went on to be not as bad, but worse than all the other promotion companies out there. I'm up in the air. I'm 50-50 on that one, Bill, but I'll tell you something. A company like Ricky Hatton Promotions, that's something that makes me excited, you know? So hopefully these guys...
Well, we just lost Dax. Dax, I know you're still talking, so you got to call us back. He won't mention it, but I will. He's referring to Golden Boy. And you know, business is business is business. And, you know, when you become a promoter, if you're going to promote, I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem. If you're going to promote your fighters and you still make money and everything else, I don't have a problem. You know, and that's been my MO with Don King. And everybody always, I was in a conversation with this at a wedding I was at over the weekend. And, you know, somebody, they start talking about Don King. Oh, he rips off all the fighters. I'm like, you know, this is the way it works. You know, the guy offers a fighter, you know, $2 million and the fighter signs the agreement. And then a week later, he finds out Don King made $10 million. And then he complains that he ripped him off. That I don't get into. But anyway, I mentioned it for you, Dax. I said who the promoter was, and that was Golden Boy.
But I heard that. See, I have Fight Now TV.
Yeah. So finish your thought. We lost you there for a sec.
Yeah, and I did the same thing like I always do. I'm sitting there rattling on, and all of a sudden, you know what? If I didn't hear you say, Dax, we lost him, I'd have kept going.
Yeah, no, I know. That's what I was trying to tell you, because you can hear me for some reason, and we lose you. Let's talk about a couple of the fights this weekend. First and foremost, Gamboa against Michael Ferranis. You know, I think that at first I chuckled to myself when they announced that fight. But, you know, the more I as I'm preparing to do my breakdowns and stuff tomorrow, I think that's a tough fight back for him, considering, number one, he's moving up in weight. Number two, he hasn't fought in over a year. What's your thoughts?
Yuri Gamboa was exciting. We love to watch him fight. He makes great fights. But you know something? I haven't seen him I really personally haven't seen him get any better defensively over the years. So coming back with a tough fight after all this time, yeah, it's nice to see him come back and, you know, not look for too much of a pushover opponent. But is that the wrong move for him right now? Because unless he's come back and he's changed a lot. So I'm up against the wall on that one. I'd like to say Yuri Urkis is going to win it, but I won't be surprised if he doesn't.
You know, we have a competitive fight, you know, from the guy I keep joking with you about, the guy you hang out down at the convenience store drinking coffee. Patrick Hyland is taking on Javier Fortuna. You know, that's the more I look into that fight, I mean, I'm not that convinced on Hyland yet. You know, he's had a pretty weak road and everything. Fortuna's had some tough fights, but this is a pretty evenly matched fight. How do you see this one going?
I'm going to go with Fortuna. Unless Fortuna, for some reason, is shot, and, you know, unless he just comes in there and he looks to wait too long, Hyland is great out of the gate. He's a thoroughbred coming out of the gate, but after that, he doesn't impress me at all. So
yeah.
I'm going to go with Fortuna on that one. You know, I'd like to see Patrick win. Like I said, he is right down the road. Maybe once in a while he'll come out of his pocket and he'll pay for the coffee. But, you know, I'm not looking too high on that one. I don't expect too much.
Miguel Kessler and Brian McGee. You know, this one I can't figure out. Maybe you can straighten me out on this one. It's for the WBA's super middleweight title. Now, Miguel Kessler, he just recently won some silver belt in the light heavyweight division. And Brian McGee has been fighting and making title defenses for the, I think he's got the interim WBA belt. Well, what's going on with the WBA super middleweight belt? Does Brian McGee, is he the champ?
Brian McGee is the champ, as far as I know. He was the interim champ, you're right. And I believe he was upgraded to the champ.
Oh, so basically the WBA is giving Kessler yet another shot at winning their title back, because that's basically the title he bought from the WBA, right?
The WBA, yeah. Matter of fact, he's had a WBA title for how long now in one version or another, all the way dating back before he fought Joe Calzacchi. So, I'm not really sure how he got this fight. Miguel Kessler has been anything but impressive. How he jumped up to light heavyweight. He has a light heavyweight title. And then, you know, all of a sudden, you know, not a world title, but I think the silver belt. And then now he jumps back down and he gets himself a title shot right away. What has Miguel Kessler done as a super middleweight lately to even garner himself a world title fight? But, you know, it's the WBA, so what are you going to do?
Well, plus he also sells out in Denmark, so that's the other thing. Hey, what's your prediction? A big fight, Manny Pacquiao against Juan Manuel Marquez. We got some coverage going on there. You know that we're doing the show right after the weigh-in tomorrow night. Then we got the post-fight show happening immediately after the event. What's your thoughts on this one, regardless of the fact that, you know, you, like me, didn't think it was the right time? But nonetheless, they're getting in the ring. Who's going to win and how?
I think Juan Manuel Marquez is going to win, and I think he's going to win by a unanimous decision. Manny Pacquiao, unless, you know, this time, which from, you know, any reports I know of, he hasn't really done anything different in his training camps. Every time we write Juan Manuel Marquez off, or I write Juan Manuel Marquez off, he comes back and he proves me wrong. And I just really think he wants this one bad, and I think he actually is the hungrier of the two. He is looking, in my opinion, and from what I hear, he is looking to retire. He is looking to go down the, you know, that stretch, you know, into the land of being a legend. Let's face it, he is a legend. And, you know, he wants that one last win, and this is the guy that has been a thorn in his side. And in my opinion, I think in everybody's opinion, he holds wins over Manny Pacquiao, just not on paper. he's going to make that decisive on Saturday night.
Sounds good. I'm sure you're going to be around to chat with me after the fight, right?
Absolutely. Come on now. I'm the showstopper.
There you go. There you go. When you come in, the show stops, you know. No. But we got to get people in the chat room, and we're going to open up the phone line so everybody that's been wanting to call in. Hey, one last thing. What's your thoughts on the new news with Mayweather? You know, he's announced through his many spokespeople that he will be fighting twice next year, and he wants to rename Cinco de Mayo to Cinco de Mayweather. One fight against we don't know, and in May, and then September 14th, the two names that he's talking about, of course, Robert Dos Guerrero and Saul Alvarez. No mention of Manny. I don't think the fight's ever going to happen. What's your thoughts on Mayweather fighting either of those two guys, and will Pacquiao Mayweather happen?
Pacquiao Mayweather, I don't know. You know something? I think Pacquiao Mayweather will happen because it's coming at the point now where they actually need each other more than, you know, the fans want them to need each other. I liken it to the old Zab Judah situation where, you know, there was that big build-up to when he was going to fight Judah. Judah lost. Mayweather went ahead with it anyway. And a lot of that depends on what happens with Manny versus Juan coming up this Saturday. As for him fighting twice next year, I'll see it when I believe it. How long has it been since he's actually fought twice in 1 year? Or if he has, when has it been, you know, against a quality opponent and a guy who's actually going to go in there and test him? You know, renaming Cinco de Mayo to Cinco de Mayweather, you know, that's just laughable. Floyd is one thing, and he's a salesman. So in that term, you know what I mean, I got to applaud him for that one. As for fighting Robert Guerrero, that's not going to happen unless Robert Guerrero suddenly has to go in full body traction.
I think he's going to underestimate Guerrero, you know, and I think he takes him. I don't know. I think he fights Guerrero, but I think Floyd beats Alvarez kind of easily. I think he has more trouble. The only two fighters out there that I see giving Floyd any kind of trouble, I'm not saying they beat him, but any kind of trouble, is Guerrero and Pacquiao, you know. But Saul Alvarez, no trouble at all. No trouble. I think Mayweather beats him easily.
Sounds very hittable, and Floyd. And, you know, as you were saying before, and we're mentioning before, you know, Alvarez is learning on the job. Floyd's style is perfect for a kid like that who has to use his bulk and has to bull rush himself in and use his power to try and dominate a guy. He has horrible offense. Floyd will lay on those ropes. He'll use that shoulder roll to pot shot him all night. And, you know, I'm not really that certain on exactly how strong Alvarez's chin is. Floyd might even knock him out.
Yeah, I think Floyd can knock him out because I'm not saying it because he has a weak chin, and I'm not saying because Floyd is got any kind of power. I just think that he will knock him out because Saul Alvarez, when he delivers his punches, he's standing right in front of you, and he kind of locks his knee. That's something I noticed a couple of fights ago. When he delivers his punches, he literally locks his knees in place. He doesn't have that bounce, and that's going to be Taylor for Floyd. Floyd's going to be able to counterpunch him to death. I think you're right. I think Floyd stops him.
I look at that. I think that fight will go a lot like the Ricky Hatton fight did. You know, Alvarez will come in. He'll bull. You know, he'll keep Floyd against the ropes. And, you know, Floyd will let his over-anxiousness work against him. And he'll pot shot him. And then again, if Joe Cortez is the referee, then, you know, you got a 21-year-old Alvarez fighting two grown men in there.
Exactly.
So I definitely see Floyd winning that one and without much trouble.
I would have liked to have seen, I'm not saying it would have been any different, but I would honestly would have liked to have seen Ricky Hatton fight Floyd without Joe Cortez breaking him up every single time. That fight, that's what has made me so anti-Joe Cortez. Between that fight and you know, his ridiculous, I mean, that he lost control in the Mayweather-Ortiz fight. You know, what was that other fight where he jumped in front to try and stop the fight, and it looked like he was doing it in slow motion? He's just a clown. I can't believe it. I can't believe that they even go to him on Showtime. But
you know, more commercialism.
As yeah, but who cares?
Joe Cortez really has dropped in quality, but commercialism.
Yeah, but
mainstream fans know his name, so if they have Joe Cortez in there, You know, I'm firm but fair. There's something else to sell. If you ever notice, whenever they mention Joe Cortez's name on HBO or something, they was, oh, it's firm but fair, Joe Cortez.
Yeah. Well, what does he bring to the broadcast? Can you give me, before we let you go, and we got a minute, yeah, tell me one thing that Joe Cortez brings to a broadcast while you're watching a fight. One thing that you enjoy.
Have you ever had a conversation with Joe Cortez in person?
Yeah, and he doesn't even.
That's about as exciting as he is at the broadcast.
I know, but it's even worse when he's behind a mic. You know,
exactly.
I mean, at least when I talk to him in person, I can understand him. You know, but when he's behind the mic, I can't understand a word he's saying, and it's not because of his accent. It's because he speaks like he's got a mouthful of gravel.
Joe always talks with his. If you ever, when you told him, you know, next time you're at the Hall of Fame or something, you run into him, you sit there and talk to him. I don't know. I think he's trying to smile while he talks because his teeth are always together.
Listen.
It's like he's talking right through his teeth. Does he have dentures? I don't know.
I think he's talking through his you-know-what, and it's the opposite end of his teeth.
Too much poly grip? He can't open his mouth?
No,
I have no idea, Joe, but your time is coming, going, in my opinion.
I think
he's firm but fair.
I think he's talking out his you-know-what, not his teeth. But, yeah, that's all he can say clearly. But, Dax, great job. We'll look forward to you tomorrow at the post-weigh-in show.
Absolutely, the post-weigh-in show, the post-Pacquiao fight, and don't forget our own Tony Treem's going to be there. Everybody have a great weekend, plenty of action to watch, and don't forget, you know, you heard that straight from the ratings booster down by Brewster.
All right, brother, we'll talk to you later. That's Dax Khan giving us his boxing schedule roundup, and he's getting to be as bad as Joe Cortez with his little coined phrase there, you know, when he starts, you know, holding the mic in front of him as we're trying to Disney, he's going, it's the ratings booster from Bruce. It's the waiting booster from Bruce. You know, yeah, come on, man. Come on. Come on. Hey, listen, we're going to take a short break. When I come back, we do have a fight that's going on tonight. I'm going to break it down. It's not part of our challenge. I'm going to give you all the challenge. I got 15 fights as part of our Billy C challenge this weekend. I told you guys, if you're waiting to join up, I'm telling you, if you join up for this week, you will be eligible for the prizes for December and, of course, the end of the year. And speaking of prizes for November, we will have November's winner posted over the weekend. So for all the challenge members, I know you're biting your fingernails wondering, did I win December's?
Talking boxing with Billy C. Every week, 2 hours of the best boxing talk on the radio.
I have a bunch of questions, Donnell, right? If you feel like you want to, you can answer for J.D. first. Why will you win? J.D. Chapman, why will you win?
Maybe Holmes will get sick and get hit by a train that day on the way to the title. He might have diarrhea. He might have the flu. He might throw up. One of his eyeballs might fall out that day, and I might get lucky.
Talking boxing.
With Billy C. If you want your voice heard on Talkin' Boxing with Billy C, then call our hotline at 845-228-8710. Leave a voicemail, or you could just tell Billy C that you like his mustache.
Can I ask you your opinion about this idea?
I'm just trying to give you the encouragement.
Listen, all I need from you is to make sure you don't hang up on people.
And if we like your call, we'll play it back on the air.
Billy, you have the knowledge and wisdom of boxing because of what you do and how well you do.
Leave your name, hometown, and what you think of the show. 845-228-8710. We want to hear you. Talking boxing with Billy C. Every week, 2 hours of the best boxing talk on the radio.
Mike Tyson looked like he put on some pounds. He was fat. He went into McDonald's and he just said to them, hey, give me 6 of everything on the menu. He put on 2 watches and covered 2 time zones. I'm talking fat here. Got on a scale the other day and it said, come on, one of you guys got to get off. Last thing I heard is that he jumped into the ocean and he left a ring around the continent. He's fat.
Boxing.
With Billy C.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. He may not have an Excellence in Broadcasting Award, but the night's still young.
And he's got martinis.
So you never know what may be by morning. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Children!
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. And a little another song from Twisted Sister's Christmas album, Silver Bells. Twisted Sister style. A little different than Grandpa used to play, right? But anyway, don't forget about Fight Now, man. If you don't have Fight Now on your sports channel lineup, listen, don't miss out on another full weekend of boxing on Fight Now. Call your local television provider and tell them that you want the Fight Now channel added to your sports channel lineup. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call. If you ask for it, you'll get it, but you got to ask for it. For all the information about the channel, you can find it on their website, www.fightnow.com. But anyway, yeah, it's Christmas, so we are playing some Christmas stuff, Christmas-related stuff. And I did the Twas the Night, the Billy C version of Twas the Night a little earlier before my man Dax came on. And I'm actually going to send the three I found. I found three. I guess we only did three. We did that one. We did my version of 12 Days of Christmas. And there's another one, I think. It was sort of like, I don't know, it's just the title. I forgot what it's about. The title just says Christmas Card. But I'm going to send those to Murphy. Ask them if anybody else wants them, just drop me an email. I'll be glad to send them to you. We used to send them out. I believe there might even be, for the premium podcast subscribers, you may be able to get a copy of it on the podcast. I know that they were up there at one time, so you'll have to check those out. We don't know if we're going to do another one this year or not. They are pretty, believe it or not, it's pretty time-consuming. It has to be written, and it has to be, you know, recorded and produced, and, you know, no. But I don't know, man. If you like them, I'll do them. You know, they were fun. I like that one. That was my favorite. That was hard to do. It really was. But anyway, we got a fight tonight. It's Friday Night Fights. No, it's Thursday. But ESPN's having Friday Night Fights on Thursday. And we got a pretty good matchup as the main event. Raimundo Beltran is going to get up against Ji-Hoon Kim. And Ji-Hoon Kim, he seems to have been on ESPN for a long time. Been on a lot, I should say. Raimundo Beltran, well, people wrote him off. That was up until his last fight. The guy is 31 years old. He's ranked number 8 as a lightweight by the computer rankings. His record, 26 wins, 17 come by knockout. He's got 6 losses. He was only stopped twice of those 6 times. He's currently the NABF lightweight champion that he wrestled away from Hammer and Hank Lundy in his last fight, which was July of this year. He's 5 foot 8 inches tall. He's got a 68-inch reach. He's got 151 rounds as a pro with a 53% knockout ratio. He's fought some tough guys in his career. He's done well and not so well against them. You know, David Torres was a fighter that had a record of 21-1. That was supposed to be a big fight for Beltran, and he got blown out in that one. And I'm sorry, he knocked out Torres in 7 rounds. But the fight he got blown out at was Amith Diaz, who you'll see in a second was a similar opponent for Ji-Hoon Kim. But both fighters had different results. Amith Diaz knocked out Raimundo Beltran, one of his only 2 stoppages in his career. He was stopped in the 4th round. He also fought recently, about a year or so ago, in May of last year, Sharif Bogory, who's an up-and-coming lightweight. He lost a 10-round decision. I think most people claimed that Beltran was like a journeyman after that fight. I thought that fight was a lot closer than the scorecards. It's on the books as a unanimous decision, but I recall that that fight was a little closer than Bogory wanted. I think Beltran came on towards the end in that fight, but nonetheless, Bogory had amassed enough points lead in the beginning of the fight. He filed that one with one of those get-back-in-the-W column fights against a guy with a really losing record. And then he got another shot against a good fighter in Luis Ramos Jr. and lost a 10-round decision. It was a lackluster performance, really, on Beltran's part. And then that's when he signed to fight Hammer and Hank Lundy. Most people thought that that was the end of Beltran, and instead, it was a great fight. And Beltran won a majority decision. I didn't even know if it was as close as that. I think it was most recently the biggest fight of his career. And that's what set him up for this fight against Jin-Hoon Kim. Now, he has 151 rounds as a professional with a 53% knockout ratio. Now, Jin-Hoon Kim, well, you know, believe it or not, you know, he seems like a youngster. He's 25 years old. He is young. But he seems to have been around for a long time. He's been fighting since 2004. He was moved over here in the U.S. He is actually a former world champion. He was a IBO world champion in the super featherweight division back in 2009. He's also challenged for the world lightweight title, came up short against Miguel Vasquez back in 2010. And many people thought that that was the end of him, especially since he followed that fight up 2 months later against Leonardo Zapovinga and was blown out in one round. You know, the problem with Jihoon Kim is that he doesn't have that, what's it called? Oh, yeah, defense. You know, he comes right out and uses the old face block, you know. He's ranked number 15 in the world in the lightweight division, lower than Beltran. His record, 24 wins, 18 coming by knockout. He's got 7 losses, was stopped twice. The one time I mentioned the blowout against Zapovinga, and then early in his career for like his fifth fight in Korea. He was stopped by a pro debut guy. You know, in his last 3 fights, you know, they were all against decent. Well, the one guy that he fought in Korea, he struggled with, Dong Hook Kim, and he was 3-0 fighter, and he squeaked out a split decision. And then he came back to the States, and he had 2 tough fights. I believe both were on ESPN. Yakubu Amadou, who is a fighter that that actor works with him. I always forget his name, but big comedian. He's a funny guy. I like him. But that was a very entertaining fight. Kim won that fight via a unanimous decision. But honestly, I think that that was an extremely close fight. I thought it could have went either way, especially when Amadou started coming on towards the end. But extremely exciting. And I thought I saw an improvement in Jihoon Kim when he came back and fought again. As recently this year, both of those fights were this year. He fought in May against Alisher Rahimov, and Rahimov was undefeated. And I think that Jihoon Kim was actually brought in as the opponent, sort of like he is today on tonight's fight. He's on the opponent's side. But in that fight against Rahimov, he looked pretty good, and you know, he dominated Rahimov, especially in the beginning. Again, he faded a little bit at the end, but I started to see a little more skill, and I'm saying to myself, you know, here's a 25-year-old that was never taught really how to fight. He's been thrown in with some tough fighters. If you look at his schedule, when you go all the way back to really in 2009 when he fought Zolani Malari, you know, since then, with the exception of that one fight with an inexperienced guy, undefeated nonetheless, but inexperienced, he's been in there with some top contenders. His record, I already told you, he's got 166 rounds as a pro with a 58% knockout ratio. He's 5'9" and a half inches tall. He's going to have an inch and a half over Beltran, which is strange when you think of a Korean fighter. Usually they're smaller, but who's going to win? Well, this isn't part of our challenge, but I have a feeling Jihoon Kim is going to win. Although Beltran is, you know, on a positive, you know, it's still, he's 31 years old. I think Kim is going to bring it to him. I think Beltran is a kind of a fighter that likes to ease into a fight. I think Jihoon Kim is going to try and start fast-paced and maybe take Beltran out of his game a little bit. I'm picking Jihoon Kim in this game, in this fight. I like Kim. I think it's going to be an entertaining fight. It'll be on tonight, so make sure you tune in to that one. You know, speaking of the challenge, I'll give you the Billy C fights that are going to be on the challenge for this weekend. And this 15. Now, we will officially send them to everybody. Now, if you want to be part of the challenge, it's very simple. All you have to do is email me, Billy at TalkinBoxing, TalkinBoxing.com, and I will hook you up. Now, here's the deal. One of the rules is that you got to have 20 fights under your belt before you become eligible to win prizes. Well, there's 15 for this weekend. You know, so if you join this weekend, I'm telling you right now, I'll guarantee you, as much as I'm sitting here overweight with a mustache, that, you know, the bottom line is there'll be 20 fights for the month of December. So if you get involved now, you still have a shot at winning not only December but the year end. So, I mean, if you come in now and blow everybody away, that would be great, you know. So if you want to join the challenge, Billy at Talkin' Boxing, TalkinBoxing.com. If you want to check out the ratings and the rankings and all that stuff, visit the website www.billycboxing.com, and you will see who's where. Now, you know, there's a lot of fights this weekend, and they're pretty good. There's a lot of good ones, and I think this is going to be one of the toughest challenges that we've had to date. Here we go, and the order that I'm going to probably present them is as follows. Holly Holm against Diana Prazak. That fight's taking place tomorrow night. We also have Ali Funica against Alani Morali. That's on Saturday. Also on Saturday, we got Nicholas Walters against Dallas Prescott. That fight is a huge fight for the Bahamas. Actually, I'm sorry, for Jamaica. Nicholas Walters is a Jamaican fighter who's very popular in Jamaica. He's like a hometown hero, so a lot of pressure on him. That is for the world title, the WBA featherweight world title, same one that Celestino Caballero decided that he wasn't going to fight for because he didn't like the purse bid that no one bid on. So that's how that fight came about. The next fight that we're talking about will be Giovanni Segura, one of my favorite fighters, man. I love this little guy, man. And I say little because he's a flyweight. He's taking on Glenn Donaire. That's going to be part of our challenge. Sonny Boy Yarrow against Juan Jose Montes. That's another good one. Sonny Boy Yarrow was considered a journeyman fighter, but, you know, he really turned his career around. Now he's in the top 10. Now, Juan Jose Montes, he's a WBF champion, and this is a good test for him. This is a very competitive fight, so that's part of our challenge as well. And we also have the Kessler and McGee fight on our challenge. We got Luis Ramos against Ricardo Williams on the challenge. We have Jose Nueves against Glenn Porras. That fight's in the bantamweight division. That's also going to be a televised fight on Telemundo. Jesse Vargas against Vito Gasparian. You know, this particular fight, it will be televised. It's coming at us from Las Vegas. Jesse Vargas. You know, Jesse Vargas, I don't know about this guy. You know, I mean, first of all, I question a couple of his wins, you know, and I'll get to that in detail tomorrow. You know, he was a Mayweather product. And, you know, Floyd Jr. actually had real high hopes for him. And all of a sudden he jumps ship and goes with Top Rank. And, you know, in his last fight, I was ringside for it in Las Vegas. He looked good. You know, I just think he might be behind where he should be. Now, this particular fight that he's in, I don't see it as being that competitive, to be honest with you. One of the reasons why we have it on our challenge is because it's televised. We try to take the fights that everyone can watch. So the televised fights is really the main, you know, criteria to get them onto the challenge. So, and this is a televised fight. But I would have thought that he would have fought a tougher opponent than Vito Gasparian. So, you know, are they pulling the old Floyd? Are they just waiting? Are they just, you know, waiting to get their shot? I don't know, man. But we do have that one on there. We also have a good fight. James DeGalley against Fluencio Zuniga. Now, that's going to be on the challenge as well. You know, James DeGalley is a fighter that many people thought should be undefeated. But the one thing, I can't stand when fighters, and this particular fight is for a title too, he's already booked for another fight. He's already booked for a fight in January. I mean, that is, you know, to me, that's a fighter looking not too seriously upon his opponent. Now, I know he doesn't make the schedule, but Zuniga's not a layup fight, especially for DeGalley. You know, I'm not taking anything away from DeGalley, but, you know, or DeGale is how you pronounce it, but Zuniga is not an easy fight for him. So I don't know, man. I would be concentrating on the guy in front of me if I'm James DeGale. So anyway, in the next fight we're going to be doing is probably one of my favorite fights of the week. And no, it's not the pay-per-view. This one's the Bryant Jennings against Bowie Tatupu. And, you know, this is a big test yet again for Bye Bye Jennings. I think that this kid is the real deal, and I'm looking forward to this fight. So he's going to be on that one. So we'll be looking forward to that fight. That's for sure. At least I am. Also on the card will be also on the challenge will be Javier Fortuna against Patrick Hyland. Dax and I talked about that one. Miguel Vasquez against Mercito Gesta. That, ladies and gentlemen, could very well be the fight of the weekend. Mercito Gesta was a fighter that I've underestimated big time, and I've learned over the last year or so that this guy's a real deal, and he's taken on another real deal in Miguel Vasquez. So tough fight for both of those guys. The Gamboa Michael Farinas fight. Yes, that's going to be on the challenge. And, of course, the Manny Pacquiao against Juan Manuel Marquez. What is it all equal? 15 fights, man. 15 fights we got on the challenge. So I'm looking forward to all 15. They all look pretty competitive, really. But anyway, talk about some fights that are coming back to Turning Stone. You know, Turning Stone's not that far from me. It's like 2.5 hours. They had some decent fights there in the past, and then we didn't see fights for a long time, and they're trying to get back in the mix. And they've already scheduled a fight for early in January, January 25th, at the Turning Stone. And the main event is going to be Ruslan Pradognikov, who's only been beaten once, 22 wins, 1 loss, 15 come by knockout. And he's going to be taking on Jason Parraga, who's got 30 wins and a couple of losses. That's the main event. It's an ESPN card. I'm looking forward to that as we kick off the year. And, you know, real quickly, I know I'm running out of time, but, you know, and Dax does his boxing schedule roundup for the weekend. But, you know, real quickly, if you take a look at what we got down the pike for the rest of the year, on December 11th, which is Tuesday, Lucas Brown, which is a former MMA fighter, he's going to be taking on Richard Towers. Now, we were just talking about this, Richard Towers. We were talking about him the other day with our very own Dan the Man Henderson as a young heavyweight. And this is going to be one of those Hatton cards. He's got this other division that is over in the Asian Pacific area, Hong Kong, China, all of that stuff. So that's going to be taking place on Tuesday. That's a decent fight. December 13th, we have a featherweight. That's actually wrong. I just saw an error on my thing. December 14th is what I meant to say. Jean Pascal is returning to the ring. He's going to be taking the main event there in Montreal. Also on that card, Logan McGuinness against Carlos Manuel Reyes, and we'll see what happens in that fight. So big fight return of Jean Pascal, so we'll be looking at that one. Danny O'Connor is back in action in December 14th. He's taking Derek Silveira on. A big card, Georgie Groves and Ricky Burns they're going to be fighting on December 15th. If you remember, Groves is taking on Glenn Johnson, so that's another one. Ricky Burns is taking Liam Walsh on. So, as far as I know, one of those was canceled, but we'll see what happens there. Arthur Abraham returns to the ring against Boudla on December 15th. Amir Khan and Carlos Molina, are fighting on December 15th. The new fighter for Burns was Jose Ocampo. I knew that Walsh was out of that one. I have it here. So December 17th is the big fight we announced. Dennis Lodebev is taking on Santiago Salgado, but that's not the one we announced. We're announcing Shannon Briggs returns to the ring on the 17th. Victor Keo is back in the ring on December 17th. December 19th, Will Rowinski OG Griffin, Otis Griffin, is the main event December 19th. December 21st, I love this name, Seasons Beatings, Pendarvis against Clark will be fighting. Adamack and Cunningham are fighting December 22nd. We got Also on December 22nd, we got Christian Escobedo taking on, I think he's taking on Malcolm Tunico. That's not official yet. Marco Antonio Rubio is going to be taking on Michael Rosales. That's on December 22nd. On December 31st, New Year's Eve, we got four world title bouts taking place in Japan. Also on January 4th, Friday Night Fights kicks off for 2013 with Kid Blast. That's right, Arnash Barthelemy. He's 17-0. And he's going to be, I'm sorry, Rancis Barthelemy is taking on Arash Yusumani. Both undefeated fighters are going to be knocking off, kicking off the Friday Night Fights 2013 year. And also January 19th in Brooklyn for the WBA Super Junior Welterweight and WBC Junior Welterweight titles, Danny Garcia is going up against Zab Judah. Peter Quinlan and Jermaine Taylor are on that one as well. A good fight January 19th at my favorite place to go watch fights at Mohegan Sun. We have Sergey Kolayev is taking on Gabriel Campillo. What a fight that one is. Devon Alexander, Kell Brook, January 19th. Another good one. You know, Andre Ward and Kelly Pavlik. I'm not too happy about that one. That's January 26th. Daniel Giel and Anthony Mundane, January 30th. February 2nd. Sam Solomon finally returns to the ring. He's taking on Felix Sturm, which is going to be a good one. We got Jürgen Brammer taking on Edward Gutneck, February 2nd. And also on February 2nd in Albany, Tom Hanks, not Tom Hanks. Tom Hanks is an actor. Imagine if he, Joe Hanks, is going to be fighting. Now, he's fighting again, I believe, tonight. I think he's fighting tonight in California. And February 9th, which I just said, Garcia and Judah. Did I say that was the wrong date? Did I say that, yeah, it's February 9th is that fight. So anyway, and don't forget Mike Tyson kicks off his tour on February 12th, so in Indianapolis. So, you know, the bottom line, why did I go through all of that? I don't know why I started, but the bottom line is, you know what? We're in a resurgence, and it's continuing. Through the new year, so I'm excited about that.
Wake up, it's time for the
It's Too Early
for a trivia question.
Question.
And today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question. Question is being brought to us by Gleason's Gym in Brooklyn, New York. Give them a call today, 718-797-2872. That's 718-797-2872. Tell them Billy C sent you. And by the way, if you like the modern way of getting a hold of Gleason's, all you got to do is visit our website, www.billycboxing.com, and click one of the Gleason's Gym banners. Yesterday's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question, I thought it was going to be a little tougher than it was. We got a lot of correct answers, but guess who was the first one? The question was, who was the first fighter to win world titles in different weight classes? Go ahead, take a guess. Who do you think won? That's right, the new trivia man himself, Henry Haskep. He knew that Bob Fitzsimmons was the very first. In 1891, he was a world middleweight champion. In 1897, he was a world heavyweight champion. And in 1903, he became the light heavyweight world champion. And that's a little tidbit for you, because the next guy to go and become a heavyweight champion and then drop back down to win a light heavyweight championship was Roy Jones Jr. So congratulations to Henry Haskep. Now, here's the deal. You know, it's sometimes it's harder to beat him, so we asked him to join us. And that's right, Henry Haskep is going to be providing the trivia questions. That's right, they're going to be the Henry Haskep trivia questions. And instead of getting a prize, you know, he just got we just sent him a copy of the Billy Minsky book. He actually gave me today's question. So today's It's Too Early for a trivia. Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question. Is courtesy of Henry Haskep, and kicking off the new year, it's going to be called the Henry Haskep Trivia Question. So actually, we're kicking it off now. So the question is this: who holds the longest knockout streaks in heavyweight championship defenses? Who holds the longest knockout streaks in heavyweight championship defenses? If you know the answer, email me, Billy at TalkinBoxing, that's TalkinBoxing.com. Who holds the longest knockout streaks in heavyweight championship histories? If you know, in championship defense, defenses. If you know that, Jesus, I'm having a hard time with this question. I want to know, and I'm going to give you a hint right now. There's two of them, all right? Which two fighters hold the longest knockout streaks in heavyweight championship defenses? Phew. Email me, damn it. Billy at TalkinBoxing, TalkinBoxing.com.
This day in boxing history.
And finally, our This Day in Boxing History is being brought to us by Campanaro and Tomkovich. That's right. If you're looking for a lawyer, use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That is Campanaro and Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099. That's 845-221-4099. Let Campanaro and Tomkovich knock out your legal problem. 845-221-4099 is what you call. Speaking of the man, he just popped into the chat room right now. Henry Haskup just missed all the accolades we just gave him. But don't worry, Henry. We just asked all the ladies and gentlemen your first question. And don't be giving out the answer in there either. That's for sure. But anyway, on this day, December 6th in 1997, Keith Mullings knocked out Terry Norris in the ninth round to win the WBC World Junior Middleweight title, and that took place on this day, December 6th in 1997, in Atlantic City, New Jersey. Hey, man, that concludes our show for today. I got to remind you a couple of things. Number one, don't forget to sign up for Fight Now TV. It's very important that you do that. You call your local television provider right now, whether it's cable or satellite, and tell them you want Fight Now right now. That's number one. Number two, for all the information about Fight Now, you can visit their website, www.fightnow.com. That's number two. Number three, Fight Now has got over 20 hours of additional coverage on the Manny Pacquiao and Juan Manuel Marquez fight, including our show tomorrow starting at 6:30 p.m. That's p.m., our post-weigh-in show, and then immediately following the Marquez Manny Pacquiao fight on Saturday night. Tune it in right here on Fight Now to watch the Billy C post-fight show. One last thing I want to remind you guys is this. If you liked the Christmas thing we did, email me, billy@talkinboxing.com. I'll be glad to send you today's, and I'm going to play the other ones that I found as well later in the week. So if you like that kind of stuff, whatever. And if you want us to do another one, I'm curious to hear about that too. So drop me an email, billy@talkinboxing, T-A-L-K-I-N. BOXING.com, but there is one more thing. Make sure you tune in tomorrow morning, same bat time, same bat channel. Well, there's only one channel. It's the Fight Now channel. Call your local television provider and tell them you want the Fight Now channel, ABC Sports Channel. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call for all the information about the channel. You can find it on our website, www.fightnow.com. See you all tomorrow. Ciao, baby.